Lowe again. It was unlikely he would become a Saint Bernard, but he did turn into a Great Dane. One of our favorites among Warner Brothers' fabulous company of actors during the 40s and 50s. Please join us in welcoming the popular Dane Clark. Also with us today is the lovely Mrs. Clark, Geraldine. And now, here's your puckish man of the half hour, Skip E. Lowe.
Today I grew up here in Hollywood when I was a little kid. I used to go to HPS, which was Hollywood Professional Schooling on Hollywood Boulevard in Western Avenue. And Mrs. Manning was my principal. And I was living in Toluca Lake with my mother. And I had an agent. I was like 12 years old, 13, something like that, or 14, I don't know. I had an agent, his name was Sid Gold, and he used to send me out all the time for little parts, you know. And I'll never forget the time when I was at Warner Brothers Studio, which is the biggest studio in Hollywood, was and still is. Warner Brothers, the commissary, oh, that afternoon, that commissary had people like Humphrey Bogart, Johnny Garfield, Alexis Smith, and guess what? And Sidney Greenstreet, I gotta leave that out. I can't leave that out. But there was a guy sitting there talking with Alexis Smith. And I said, my God, there is Dane Clark. Oh, he was a big idol of mine. I just loved him. Not because he was small like I was, but he was a giant of an actor. And Dane Clark, you made my day that time. I'll never forget Warner Brothers that afternoon. How are you, Dane?
I'm fine now that you give me a build-up.
Dane Clark, Warner Brothers, actor. Name is Herbert, is it really? Herbert, is it Herbert before?
No.
What was it?
It was Bernard.
Bernard, ah, okay.
I'm not too happy about that either.
Okay, Bernard, tell me, who gave you the name Dane Clark?
I was endowed by that by Humphrey Bogart.
Did he really?
Yeah.
He gave it to you.
Yeah.
But Johnny Garfield had a lot to do with Dane Clark's career and life.
Oh, yes. At the very beginning, he was very important.
Right. Tell me. How?
In New York.
Right.
Well, I was in terrible financial straits and doing anything to make a living, you know.
Uh-huh.
And one of the things I did was work for a sculptress posing for a picture for her.
Uh-huh.
And she was one of these people that threw fashionables luncheons every week. And she gathered a great deal of the theater crowd in New York to be at these luncheons.
Right.
So I was there posing for a picture as a prize fighter.
Uh-huh.
And Garfield was among the people there.
Uh-huh.
And he came over to me finally and he said, what are you doing, kid? What are you doing this for? I said, gotta make a buck. He says, well, why should you be an actor? I said, what's that? He says, they're doing plays about people like you today.
Boxers, of course.
No, it was the time when if you needed to make a living, it was very important, you know.
Oh, okay.
People are financially in great stress at that time.
Uh-huh.
So I said, well, I'll do anything. What do I do? So he gave me a place to go to see a Russian director down in the village who was doing a play.
Uh-huh.
And he says, he'll use you. He likes people like you.
Uh-huh.
So I went down there, and they called my name, and I went forward, and then they said, well, you got the script. I said, what script? I didn't know what they're talking about.
Did you know?
And, I won't go into all the horrible details of giving a performance, but I gave a performance, and he liked it.
Uh-huh.
I read the script, I read the other people's lines, I didn't realize they were the ones
step
before.
Step on one lines, yeah. Right.
And that was my first introduction to the theater. And I didn't get the part.
You didn't get the part.
But infused me with a certain virus, which I never got rid of for the rest of my life.
Uh-huh. So it did affect you at the beginning.
Oh, yes, very much so.
But Dane Clark.
That was Garfield.
But you were a boxer, though. Is that right?
I was a lot of things.
What do you mean a lot of things? Like what?
Well, anybody paid me more than $5, I would be that.
And you wanted to be a lawyer. You went to school.
I went to law school.
You went to law school?
Yeah.
Tell me about that, Dane. You really worked awfully hard to become a lawyer, though. You got the degree or something, did you?
No, I didn't get my
degree. You didn't get your degree?
It was always a matter of tuition.
Uh-huh.
Which was a big
at that time,
cross
it was
in
tough.
My life.
Right. Broadway debut in 1934 or what? What was that?
Or God, I don't remember.
You don't remember your Broadway debut in 34?
Broadway debut?
Uh-huh. You did a Broadway show.
No? I was an extra in Dead End.
Okay. But when did Dane Clark come to Hollywood? And how did you wind up at Warner Brothers, Dane?
Well, I there's a long story about how I...
Is that from Johnny Garfield, because he was such a good buddy of yours?
Not really, because he went back to California. I never saw him again until I came to California.
Oh, okay.
And came to Warner Brothers. I was trying to get to see people there, and it was very difficult to see anybody at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And through some friends, I was told to go to a certain audition.
Right.
And I went there, and they were so busy, they had no time to talk to me, and they just sent me home without listening to me. Oh. It was very disconcerting and very demoralizing. And finally, Sam Wood, a famous director, I knew his girlfriend.
Right.
And he arranged for me to see the casting director.
Uh-huh.
So I went to Warner Brothers on the day, and there were like palaces, you know, which you couldn't get in with the guards and all that stuff.
Right.
But I had an okay to see this man.
Right.
And I went inside, and sure enough, I sat there for an hour, and he was busy in the office. He couldn't see me.
Uh-huh.
So I realized that this liable to happen. I had bought a hat.
Uh-huh.
And I left the hat on the chair, and they dismissed me. Say, can't see you today. But meanwhile, I walked outside and I talked to the guard at the gate and I talked about baseball and everything else.
Uh-huh.
We got into a big fancy discussion.
Uh-huh.
So he remembered me.
Uh-huh.
The next day I came back and I was going in. He said, what are you doing? I was here yesterday.
Uh-huh.
I left my hat here.
Said,
Oh, yeah. So he sends me into the room and I sit down. And I see Phil Friedman and Jerry Wald arguing about a script and saying, well, we can't play the guy. The guy's gone. So I'm listening. I said, I can play it.
Uh-huh.
They opened the door and said, who are you? I said, what difference does it make? You got to test, a lot of people test me. It's called a few feet of film, and I'll prove you what I'm saying is true.
Uh-huh.
I can play any part you give me.
Uh-huh.
And he said, arrange a test for him tomorrow.
Uh-huh.
And about 20 other people I've been testing, and I did it, and I got the part in Action in North Atlantic.
That was the part you got?
That's the part I got.
Ah.
And that started my career.
That started your career. That was a great. Who was in that film?
There was Bogart and Massey and a
Raymond
lot of
Massey.
Yeah.
Bogart.
Yeah.
But you got a good role in that part.
Oh yes.
Let's show a clip from that role. I mean, your first, very very first. Look at this role. And did you study acting at all?
No.
You're telling me, you're sitting there telling me, Dane Clark, you have never studied acting.
No, I watch a lot of acting.
I'm going to show this clip to my audience right now. I want to show what these young kids should really learn about actors. Let's see this clip film. You certainly can, of Dane Clark's first movie. Look at this, and no acting. Look, let's see. Let's show it.
Four, three,
very good.
What are you waiting for? I ain't no hurry. I figure I'm shipping out today or tomorrow.
Can't wait, can you?
If it was lucky once, we'll be lucky again.
Sure, luck is riding on our tail.
What's the matter? Don't you believe in it?
I do. I once knew a fella got bombed 3 times without being scratched. Then he drowns himself taking a swim at Coney Island.
That's the way it goes.
In a pig's eye, I'm going to get me a shore job. Why should I commit suicide at my age? For my dough, the only safe run is a Staten Island ferry.
You'd look good on a Staten Island ferry.
Yeah, and I'll go on looking good when you're inside of a shark's belly.
I don't think you'd like that Staten Island run, kid.
Why not?
Well, you got to pass the Statue of Liberty going each way, and you might not want to look her in the face.
I don't mind.
Well, what are you hanging around a hiring hall for if you ain't shipping out?
I got my rights. I'm paid up here. I'm a paid-up member of this union in good standing.
Listen, the only uniform we got is a union button, and no guy's wearing one who ain't got what it takes.
And he ain't got it.
And I ain't playing poker with no bent bucks.
What's biting you?
Come on, close your yap and deal. Deal me in.
You guys are talking like I was a kid or something, like I didn't know what the score was. Look, I've been shipping out for 6 years. one thing for you single guys not to worry in the world. Easy come, easy go.
So I ain't single. So I'm so dumb I got a wife and a kid coming next month. So I'm nervous. So my nerves is waltzing with my pulse.
Oh, pipe down.
What do you mean, pipe down? Ain't it permitted? No more free speech?
Wait a minute. Come on, sit down. Take it easy.
Don't it matter if I want to know whether my kid's going to be a boy or a girl or twins? Or like this fella says, charity begins at home, but don't account no more the home. Look, we know what's what. Guys like us killed on ships, the fish pecking at our eyes. Who cares about us anyway? Everybody's nuts about the Army and Navy. What are we supposed to be, skeletons in a closet or something? Oh, yes, and now they're going to give us medals. Medals. Oh, what good's a medal when you're washed up on the beach in a mess of seaweed? Nobody even knows what you died for. So my kid can sing my daddy lies over the ocean or under it? I want to bounce my kid on my knee. I want to be with my wife. Go on, make a law against it. Put me in a nut house for thinking things like that.
Ugh, Dane Clark. See, that, young kids today should look at these old movies, these black and white movies, and that is a lesson of itself. A man who has never had an acting lesson. You listen, it's like reacting, isn't it?
No, that's not true.
Okay, what is it? Tell me.
No, in that interim when I'm talking about, through friends I met, other friends, and they introduced me to the actor's studio.
Right.
And I used to hang around there and listen a great deal.
That's what I meant.
So I had some experience.
But you listened. You went there to the actor's studio and sat listened. In to observe.
To
you
observe.
Observed. You observed the actors.
Yeah, I watched some very good people.
Right. Yeah. But that is so good.
Yeah, my
and you loved movies those days. You watched movies and you watched the actors.
No, you I didn't watch too many. I couldn't afford them.
Dane Clark, to react with the words from one person to another is a very important thing, listening what that actor is saying and to react. Is that correct or not? Go ahead.
Well, I don't understand why everybody doesn't do that. If you're acting, it's part of life.
That's exactly it. That's what I meant.
I'm listening to you now.
Right. And
then you, if you saw that in film, you'd say, gee, he's listening very well.
Tell me about working at Warner Brothers after this film. And you see yourself on this film at night. These are on classics, on Turner Classics. Dane Clark, how do you feel in looking at a scene like that today?
Sad.
Sad?
Because I'm not playing other scenes like it.
You still like to work?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
You're not working nowadays, or is that it?
Well, not as much as I used to.
Used to. But you do work. You do a lot of TV appearances and stuff like that. Tell me about Bette Davis's and I Lupino. I Lupino and Dane Clark. We're going to get married. Is that true?
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Well, I worked in the film. We were stars of I forget the name of the film.
Mm-hmm. What was it? I think it was, I don't remember.
Deep Valley,
absolutely.
Deep Valley, yeah. And we
got a good memory, Dane.
She has a good memory,
okay,
she told me.
Okay.
And we related very well to each other as actors and actress, and we got to know each other very well.
Uh-huh.
And there was warmth there, and finally what is interpreted as love. And I proposed, and she said yes, and then I met her family.
That was
a shocking thing. It's very
really?
Sad. Yeah.
Is that what stopped the marriage?
Yeah. No, she was hooked up with that family, and they were all leeches on her, sisters and mother and all that. And
oh, I see.
It was a very unhappy situation.
The Lupino family.
The Lupino family.
Right. They're actors. They're all actors from
all
London.
London.
Yes.
Vaudevillians.
That's right. Right.
But she was the class of the act.
She was
a great actress, a great lady.
Did you learn a lot from her?
I learned from everybody.
That's interesting.
I learned from everybody.
Humphrey Bogart? Tell me about Humphrey. How was he? What kind of guy was Humphrey Bogart?
One of a kind.
Yeah.
Even Mr. Apex.
He was a real man's man, right?
Oh, yes. And he was a sardonic humor.
Uh-huh.
But a hell of an actor.
A drinker?
I see him drink. I never saw him drink to excess.
Uh-huh. Why is all that big heavyweights like Clark Gable, Humphrey Bogart, or all these big heavyweights booze it up? They love to booze it up. That's good. I like that. Robin Mitchum's and all these. That's great. That's a man's man. But why
is it? Bogey never drank to excess.
He didn't?
No.
Okay.
Because he was always on time for his work, and he was always letter perfect, and he was a wonderful, wonderful actor.
Fantastic.
You know, you hang around people like that, and it, some of it rubs off on you, and you become better all the time.
The Pride of the Marines. Love that movie. Johnny Garfield?
John Garfield, my
Oh, I just love Johnny Garfield. I know his daughter. His son just...
Robbie?
His son died. He killed himself. But the daughter I know, she's lovely. She studies at Actors Studio. And matter of fact, you're a member of Actors Studio now.
That's right.
Of New York.
Yeah.
You lived on 57th Street in New York. I one of my favorite little buildings in New York. It's not a little. It's a
little bigger building.
Van Cliburn lived in that building.
Right.
Is that right? I used to see him. I used to go to that little corner
shop. Catty corner across from Carnegie Hall.
That's correct. Right across from Carnegie Hall.
And it was at one time a home for theater people and musicians. And I would go out and punch the elevator to go down sometimes. And I'd stay in a hallway for an hour where somebody was doing a concert, preparing for a concert, playing in an upper floor. And I just flipped over the music. And the people who were musicians and actors lived in that sort of mainly.
Tell me about the Actors Studio. Let's get back to New York now. You spent a lot of time. You're new back in California because I think you just came back here just recent. But New York, Actors Studio, who are some of the members that you were with there?
Oh, Paul Newman.
I know Paul, yes. Shelley Winters.
Shelley Winters. Actually, practically everybody.
How do you get along with Shelley Winters? Tell me. She's a great...
Not too well.
Not too well?
No. Because sometimes I want to talk and never got a chance to.
Oh, okay. I understand.
But she's a very knowledgeable lady. Uh-huh. And deserves to have the center of the floor all the time. Uh-huh. But it bothered me.
Let's go back to Warner Brothers. I really want to go back. The commissary days, like I was talking earlier about the commissary. What a commissary. To walk in, to see such wonderful stars. I mean, Dane, at lunchtime.
No. There were two rooms.
There were two, yes.
A huge room which
is for the
which for ordinary people.
Ordinary people. And the other
and then
one.
A special
but
room
I,
and special, the other side.
Another side, I know.
Everybody was a star or an executive.
Yeah, I know, but I used to go in that other room, sneak in or
very,
whatever
very
I did.
Exciting.
I used to sneak in. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, but not the big room.
No, well, that's, well, you know what
they
I mean.
Were just
tell
hungry
me about
actors.
Tell, yeah, but tell us, get back with that
what
room,
you
that wonderful room. Tell me, that room was so exciting.
That room is about $5 or $6 million a week salary.
Really? God darn right.
With all
right.
the people in it.
Johnny Garfield.
My dearest friend.
You're saying your dearest friend.
My dearest friend.
You spent a lot of time together.
It wasn't the time we spent together. Well, I was with him till the day, almost to the day he died.
Really?
Yeah, we were both living out on fire. I met him out on Fire Island.
Uh-huh.
And he was a destroyed human being because they had nabbed him for left-wing activities.
Right.
And he couldn't get a job. And this was his whole life. He was an actor, pure and simple. And it was terrible to see the destruction that visited upon him.
Right.
And he would sign to do a picture in Europe, and then the last minute they got a letter back. Sorry, but something happened. They canceled it when they found out that releasing his pictures in America would be difficult. So he was just destroyed. Then I was out on the island one day on a visit, and he was there. And I said, what's happening? He says, I think I got a job, a good one now. And he told me about this play and thing. And I said, good for you, baby.
You felt the hurt there, did you?
Huh?
You felt that hurt and pain.
I lived with that hurt. It destroyed me.
Is that the group theater? That was all about the group theater?
Yeah.
With Stella Adler and all the people?
But he was
Elie Kazan?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Then while we were talking, he was so elated because he'd gotten his job in Italy, you know, and he was going over there to get it. And there was a telephone call for him down at the, you know, Fire Island has only one place where there's a phone call.
Yes.
So he ran down to the place and came back, and he was white. And I said, what's the matter? He says, they just called me and canceled the job.
Oh.
I said, I realized I had to be with this guy because he was a sick man. Uh-huh. And what happened, I said, look, we stayed there all that night, and I'll come to town with you tomorrow. You know, I want to go to town to see my wife.
Right.
And he went back, and I called him later on. He said, I'm busy. And he went out, and he just got drunk, and I think he picked up a girl or something, and he died that night. But he was a pure case of a heartbroken human being. But what a talent, and what a beautiful man.
Looking back.
And what a friend.
What a friend. That's nice. What a friend, you said. Looking back, Dane Clark, what has been the biggest lesson that you have learned?
Waiting to be trusted, mm-hmm. and trusting people. And sometimes it's very difficult.
You don't have faith in people?
I do, but you have to be very careful who you put your faith in. I put my faith in the nicest person. Right.
The nicest person is your wife, Geraldine. How are you?
Just fine.
Geraldine.
Forgive me, honey.
That's okay.
Thank you.
Geraldine Clark, married to Dane Clark for how many years?
It'll be 25 years in November.
You're a lovely lady.
Thank
photographer you.
You
were, is that correct?
Photographer's model.
Photographer's model.
Yes.
Ah, in New York City?
And all over the world.
And Europe, too.
Is that why you have such great legs? She does have beautiful legs. Tall, very tall. Geraldine.
A lot of things that are beautiful.
Geraldine met Dane Clark at one of my favorite places. Schwab's drugstore.
Right. Uh-huh.
Come on. You met there?
Met there for the first time.
Tell me, Geraldine.
Well, we met in the exact same spot. Harry Schwab told me later that Clark Gable and Carol Lombard had met at that very, very spot where we met.
The same
where Dane and I met.
In the booth?
There. No, not in the booth. It was right by the cosmetic counter. Dane was on his way home from the studio.
Okay.
He was going to cash a check, and I was with a friend purchasing some cosmetics, and she knew him, and she introduced us, and it was lightning.
Was it? He asked you for a date right there? Dinner?
No. I saw him back in New York at a party she gave, and then I said, you know, I really like him. I'd like to get to know him. So she gave a smaller dinner party.
Uh-huh.
And he was my dinner date, and that was it.
And that was the magic of Mrs. Mm-hmm. Clark and Dane Clark getting married. Any children?
No.
You got a lot of animals.
Oh, that's good. So you moved in New York in that apartment on 57th Street?
Right.
And I lived right around the corner on 58
mm-hmm.
at the Park Savoy Hotel behind the Essex House.
Yes.
And I used to run in the Essex House and make telephone calls to my agent. I loved it. That's why they were charging 50 cents for a call in the hotel room, you know, and they didn't have a phone downstairs. Tell me, Mrs. Clark, then you came to... Geraldine, tell me. You came to New York after, or where do you...
I was born in New York. Yes.
Yeah, but I meant you came to California after with Dane.
Yes.
And
yes.
You're now in real estate.
Yes.
I love it. Everyone joins real estate when they come to California.
Yes.
Oh, no, but
there
she's
are such
good.
Beautiful homes.
Is she a good real estater?
Oh, boy.
Is she?
Oh, boy.
What do you mean, oh, boy, Dane? Tell me.
Well, the amount of work she puts in is enormous.
Uh-huh.
I don't get a chance to talk to her very seldom lately.
Uh-huh.
She's buried in facts and figures and all that sort of thing. And she's very dedicated.
What made you get into that?
Well, I had been a stockbroker after I stopped modeling in New York with Shearson.
Oh.
And the stock market, frankly, was a little too early for me to get up to do in California. I would have to be up at 3 in the morning and our lifestyle would be drastically changed.
Uh-huh.
And I wanted to do something, so real estate, as far as investing, was a very natural progression. And I had done some in New York, working on some of our own properties and finding properties for friends.
Easy to get along with, Dane Clark?
Yes, we're a foot in a shoe, yes.
Uh-huh. Isn't that wonderful? That's really wonderful. Dane, you've done television. You've done a lot of television.
Yes, I've done a lot of television.
You did a lot of television,
A lot of theater, a lot of television, a lot of movies.
Theater. Let's get back to the theater. Love the theater, don't you? That's your favorite? Is that your favorite, you would say?
Love it.
Uh-huh.
Well, it's a place where you can... best way of expressing yourself.
Right.
Nobody's bothering you. You're on stage there, you're naked.
That's right.
And you damn well better be good, or they're going to throw things at you.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. I can't remember. What's the first play
What's
I did?
The first play you ever did? That's what I was going to ask you.
Well, the first thing you ever did was Waiting for Lefty.
Waiting for Lefty, that is the group theater.
Yes.
Oh, yes,
Dane,
tell me.
Yes,
tell
and
me
Dane that. Was sitting in the audience screaming, strike. And that was his first line.
Uh-huh. Strike. Tell me, is that actually, Marlon Brando did Waterfront.
Yes.
That's something like that, isn't it?
Waiting for Lefty?
Yeah.
No, Waiting for Lefty is a labor meeting.
That's right. Go ahead.
With a lot of people on the stage, all airing their views, and the rest of the membership in the audience. Uh-huh. And that's what this theater was, the stage and the audience.
I heard
and
that
we yelled
show.
Up there, and they yelled back, and it got very riotous at times. And it was a hell of a play.
Who wrote that play?
Odets.
And matter of fact, he was in trouble with Johnny Garfield. Same thing. Odets and him were in trouble. The whole group theater people. They were
most
all
of
in
them.
Most of them.
Most of them.
Stella Adler. They all had problems.
Yeah. Well, they gave him a chance to reform themselves.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of them seized it. Uh-huh. But Garfield didn't, and the other said, this is what I am, and that's what I am.
Betty Davis. I'm not even going to say a word. I just want to show this first, and then I want to get back. You and...
You're good at that.
Necessity is the mother of invention.
You by any chance an artist?
Enough of an artist to have my own opinions of this exhibition.
And you're a critic as well.
You don't have to be a critic to recognize an amateur.
What makes you so sure that she's an amateur?
Who is kidding who?
Most of the people here don't seem to share your opinion.
You mean this collection of friends? Have you heard the gab that's floating around here? They're so divine, they're so lovely.
I think I might as well tell you, I painted this collection.
I was wondering how long it would take you to say so.
How did you get in?
I walked in.
I'm surprised you took the trouble.
I was hungry and thirsty.
What do you do?
I paint.
Oh, then you are an artist.
I never had an exhibition, if that's what you're driving at. I haven't had the opportunity.
If you had the opportunity, what would you do?
Are you making me an offer?
I think I'd like to see some of your work to find out whether you're a phony or not.
Come on, I'll show you.
Now?
Now or never.
Is it far?
Not if you pay for the taxi.
I'll get my coat.
Meet you outside.
Clark, I mean, Betty Davis, working with this great Warner Brothers star. This movie was a big hit. Tell me about the scene that you were eating and what's happened there.
Well, I ate because I was hungry, and I would read the papers and find out what some socialite was having who fancied himself as a painter.
Right.
And they would throw a party for their friends.
Right.
And I would find out where these places were, and I would run there and force myself in. And he'd eat on the hors d'oeuvres.
Or right, of course.
And I stuffed myself, which I needed very much to do. And this went on. Unfortunately, it went on all day long, and I was stuffing. I got so sick in this damn part.
Uh-huh.
And that scene, I mean, because I had to
right.
keep continue the same average.
The takes over and over and over.
And
over,
and
of course.
With the same hunger.
Right.
When I hung, I was ready to throw up, you know.
Uh-huh.
Anyway, it just went on for 2 days, and I got that scene, but became anathema to me.
Right.
Because of all the food I had to partake. Now the picture's over, and we're home, and Betty and I get a call. There's a delivery, some gift coming from Miss Davis, mm-hmm. and I said, "Wow!" And the truck comes up and delivery wagon, and the beautiful box to Dane Clark with regards and respect and with love, Betty Davis. And I take it home, and I opened the thing up, and she had the leftover Savoy.
She had all those leftovers for you. I love it.
And this is about 2 weeks later.
Uh-huh. That's funny.
She's wonderful, that sense of humor.
She had a great sense of humor.